So thanks everyone for joining tonight. My name is Lorne and I'm the volunteer and education coordinator with the Green Mountain Club. You are the first participants in GMC's first Taylor Series show of the 2021 season. This is the 29th year of the club running this outdoor adventure speaker series intended to bring inspiration and adventure to people throughout the entire winter. And so especially in this season where, you know, in a normal year, we would have everybody come into the club and there'd be cookies and coffee and kind of this big hubbub environment. We're not going to be able to do that this year, obviously, but we're really excited to, as we did at the end of last year, continue offering this series virtually, which is great in some ways. You know, people can join from North Michigan and from California and all over and still be at home and doing their other things, but still have this connection. So we really appreciate you being here. And I'm looking forward to this being a productive and successful season. For those of you that don't know, the Green Mountain Club is the organization that founded Vermont's Long Trail back in 1910. The Long Trail is a 272-mile hiking trail going from the Massachusetts border to the Canadian border. Green Mountain Club also takes care of about 166 miles of side trail, the Appalachian Trail for its entirety in Vermont, and the Northeast Kingdom trails in the region of the Northeast Kingdom. So overall, around 500 miles of trail maintenance, as well as 25,000 acres of conserved land, over 1,000 volunteers, 40 plus seasonal field staff, and then these wonderful educational programs that you are all joining in now. So I think other things to say are the GMC is supported by our members. And so if you're not a member, then consider looking at membership options. And if you are, then thank you very much for your contributions. We also have a whole slate of business and corporate sponsors. The list just keeps on growing and growing. So if you're looking to go get a rowing machine, go to Concept 2. If you're looking to get a Vermont beverage, check out Burlington Beer Company. Look at the website, see the places that support the club and support this program that we do. And it's nice to go to those vendors and businesses before others because they're great to the club and we have lots of good supporters out there. I think that's for the small introduction there. I will go to the one next slide so that everybody can see what we have coming up after Sam. So this show starts, you know, today, December 17th. We're gonna take a little bit of time off for the holidays and then come back in 2021, the new year. And our speaker on Thursday, January 7th is Myrna Valerio, who's gonna be speaking about our community and the outdoors. Myrna's a Montpelier resident and an ultra runner and starred in a film called The Myrnavator. She's got a pretty enthusiastic personality and is a great speaker. And we're really excited to be able to welcome Myrna to the GMC's speaker series. So check that out online, the same place that you registered for this. You should see that up there. And then keep the other ones on your calendar. They're going to be Thursday nights at 7 p.m. And registration's easy and simple. I'll send you reminders. And we'd love to have you join for the future Taylor Series. So I think with that, Sam, I can hand it over to you. And maybe I'll just pull up that poll right now so people have it on their screens.
Okay.
Let me do one quick, I forgot about a Zoom introduction. Sorry. Everyone, if you've made it through the pandemic so far and have not used Zoom, then I'm thoroughly impressed. But if you want a reminder, then we have the chat feature, which is a great way to share something. If we ask a question and you want to answer it, if you have a wall on your property that you want more information about, then put that in the chat and use it as kind of a general announcement to Sam and myself and to the other participants here. You will notice that in the chat, there's a little drop-down tab of who it sends to. So it's fun if you can send to all panelists and attendees, because then we've just got this big community of everybody participating and somebody can say something and then Ted can answer the question. So I think that's more fun. So change your feature to all panelists and attendees. If you have a question specific for Sam or for myself, then there's another feature called the Q&A feature. And that's a great one. It's a little easier to handle and other people can see that as well. So those are the two things that you need to know. You've figured out by now that you don't have audio or video, and we do that to keep these presentations a little bit more formal. If you have any questions about Zoom, feel free to put them in the chat or the Q&A. I can help answer those. And now I'm going to start a fun thing that's going to pop up on your screen, and I would like to welcome Sam really quickly. I met Sam back in October, maybe, doing the Vermont Master Naturalist Program. If you haven't heard of it, check it out. through North Branch Nature Center. Really great way to spend a season, a year really, with a bunch of like-minded people out in the outdoors learning about nature. And Sam was pretty impressive in the knowledge of the size of a rock and a stone wall and what that means. And maybe looking at an old foundation and seeing what are the things that can be clues as to, was this a barn? Was this a stable? Was this a house? And I just thought that was really cool. And it's always a thing that I've never really had a full education of. And so Sam's got a great background, a great history, and I'm looking forward to hearing from her. And thank you so much for doing this. So I can, I need to stop sharing. Great.
Okay.
Everyone, you just had a poll pop up on your screen. We like to keep you engaged. So we'd love to know your answers to these questions. Okay. Excellent.
All right, so I am Sam, Samantha Ford. I am officially Turnstone Research, which is a research business I have that I do multiple types of research for different organizations. Most of those projects don't have to do with what we're talking about tonight, but what we are talking about tonight is one of my favorite topics, which is stone walls and cellar holes. And going out into the woods and finding these stone walls and cellar holes and using these features to read the landscape over the last 300 years and also to find out about the people who built them and lived in them, how they used their land and how they interacted with their communities. It's also important to note that today our timeline goes back about 300 years. Obviously, we have a long and rich history of Vermont history with human history that goes back thousands of years with the Abenaki. What we're talking about today starts with European contact and moves forward. And our timeline will start in 1975 when this map was first made of the state of Vermont. This is about 4 years after we became the 14th state. We were the first state after the revolution to join the United States. That's a fun history there, but we'll leave that for another time. And the 1790s is about a decade into the first wave of concentrated European settlement year-round permanently in the northern part of Vermont. And so this map, when it was created, you can kind of see all these boxes. Obviously, those are all the towns. When these towns were created and placed on this map, there wasn't really a lot of information. The people who went out and surveyed them hadn't necessarily ever been there. And so we see this first map of the town of Williston. It's not very specific. When you were handed your parcel of land, or if you purchased it from someone, as soon as you got there, you found out what you had. You could have a mountain, you could have a bunch of bedrock, or you could be lucky enough to get fertile soil. Basically, you had to get out there, figure out where your land was, and see what your lot was like. Hopefully, if you were lucky, it looked something like this. You've got this nice forested landscape and somewhat of a daunting task. You now have to clear this landscape and build a structure or shelter for your family. And oftentimes, the husband would come out first on his own, possibly with his older children or older sons, and clear the land, maybe build a log cabin. Something like this. Anyone from the islands in Vermont might recognize this one. And I would say for every pattern or rule that I try to lay out tonight, these farms and homesteads are as individual as the people who lived on them. So there will probably be exceptions to almost everything I say. but generally, the husbands would get out there first, clear the land, build shelter. Their families would either join them the next season, or families would come out and do this all together as a group. Basically, your job for the first winter was to make shelter and survive it. And so we will pick up our story in Waterbury at Little River State Park. This is the history hike trail going up Hedgehog Hill. We'll follow the story of the Ricker family, which will hopefully give us some patterns for you to follow and to start to recognize on your own as you go out into the woods and explore. But what we're looking at right now is a pretty wide, pretty hard-packed trail. You can see over time, it has been compacted down into the landscape over several years, several decades, maybe even centuries. As we start our exploration of this landscape, we'll walk up this trail and try to think about how long has it been here, and has its use changed over time from when it was first constructed, and possibly who constructed it. So as we walk up the hill, what we would hope to find would be something like this. So we've got two culverts here. The left is a corrugated, I forget if it's metal or plastic culvert, but very modern, only been in for a few decades. And on the right, we have a stone box culvert, which has definitely been there a little bit longer. Culverts are really cool, very unique structures, the stone box ones anyway, that are often some of the first examples or first clues that you can find to know that what you're walking on was originally built as a road. There were some of the earliest highway or road structures, and they were built right from the very earliest era of settlement all the way through until the turn of the 20th century. And so these stone box culverts can be quite large. Anyone who saw the intro page saw me standing at the end of a very large culvert. This is my friend Jess during the Vermont Stone Culvert survey that we were on together. This is obviously a much larger culvert, definitely more engineered. It's got a concrete cast lintel above it, it's still in service and servicing a fairly busy road. It had to be big enough to get over this waterway. A lot of craftsmanship and thought had to be put into placing these stone abutments on either side. And sometimes you get little culverts. Something else that's pretty significant about these stone box culverts, especially visible in this photo, is that they keep the stream beds intact. And that's a really important key feature. They really tried to work with the landscape when building these and often would source materials from nearby, which would be the case for this little guy. And depending on how these culverts were constructed and the materials that they use can tell us how old they are and how long they've been in use and can tell us about the communities that they service. So this was obviously placed on a much smaller waterway than the previous one, probably a much more rural road with slightly less use. We can see that these are mostly field stones, probably located right around this area, and they were stacked by most likely a local either stonemason or just someone who lived nearby and understood how to stack stones. This one is much larger. It had to support a much larger road and had a much steeper embankment, so it just required a little bit more work. And you can kind of see this is much more of a field stone construction, and without maintenance, these things do deteriorate over time. And so it's really important that we go back and help these original structures that have been here in many cases for hundreds of years continue to function normally. So if you think about like cost investment, building something like this that's meant to last forever versus those corrugated tubes that get washed out pretty much anytime you have a high water event. These guys have been around, they've survived at least for our natural disasters in Vermont. They've survived the 1927 flood, Hurricane 38, we've got Hurricane Sandy, Hurricane Irene, and it's pretty incredible to think that even something that's been sitting out in the woods for as long as this particular one has, it's still serving its original function. If we return back to our road, as we've established now at Little River, we can look at this culvert a little bit closer. It appears from here that the top lintel has probably been quarried at some point. It's much more square, much more flat than some of the other field stones we were just looking at. And so it kind of conveys a sense of strength and permanence in the community that was using this road. And it was definitely meant to last the test of time. So as we continue to walk up this hill, we'll think about this. We've now established what we're standing on. That trail was actually, in fact, a road. And thanks to what we can see on this culvert, we can know this road has probably been around for about 200 years. And then we can start to think about what has happened over those 200 years and how many different uses maybe has this road has. Was it built for logging? Was it built as a farm road? We'll have to keep walking up the hill and see what else pops out from the forest. Thankfully, we don't have to go too far in virtual land or too far uphill before we stumble across this lovely little stone wall. This stone wall is seemingly located in the middle of the woods. Obviously, it is marking off a boundary of some kind. We may think it may be property boundary. Or it may be some other kind of boundary, like around a field. And we can start to explore this stone wall, and it can start to tell us how long it's been there, exactly how long it's been since these trees have grown up around it, and what types of land use have occurred and even have occurred on either side of the wall. So originally, what we would expect to see on the landscape in the early 1800s, say 1790s, up until about maybe 1810, were fences that looked a lot like these stumps. Early fences, since you were clearing your land, if we think back to that forested shot where you were hoping to build a log cabin out of those trees, this would have been your next project. As you're clearing your land and felling the trees, you're left with a lot of stumps, and those aren't very easy to plow around or raise crops around. Early on, you could plant your wheat or your corn in between the stumps, but eventually you would need that space. And so what you would do is you could either burn your stumps to clear them from the land, or you could haul them to your field edges to make them into fences, like what we see here. This shot is actually taken from Williston, Vermont, if anyone's counting, I guess. And so these early fences were difficult to maintain. Obviously, they were sort of haphazard, but over time, wood tends to break down and rot. And as we move closer to the 1810s and to the 1820s, we're starting to see the very first wave of true deforestation in the state. And so suddenly, timber is becoming an incredibly valuable resource. And it's something that you're not going to waste on a fence where you know it's eventually going to rot. You see reports as maintaining wooden fences is perishable work. And so you really needed your wood for fuel, for heating your home, for creating your farming tools. Early on, potash was a really big cash crop because as you're cutting down all these trees, you're getting a lot of, you can burn them out for ashes. And that was used for tons of things from soap to tanning, and also very, very valuable. And so as we're starting to run out of the timber and we're not wanting to waste it on our fences anymore, there's another layer happening here to all this land clearing. As we're clearing all of these trees, we're also removing their root systems. And suddenly we're exposing all of the soils beneath them. And so when the Laurentide ice sheet retreated from this area, it dragged with it huge stone slabs that were deposited as glacial till that it broke up as it was moving along. This is a really, really, really heavy ice mass. And as the soil sort of built up on top of that till over time, and the trees grew on top of that, everything was sort of compacting the earth down and holding all of these stones down. And so suddenly you have nothing to block them anymore. And as soon as you remove the tree layer and the root layer, soil starts to freeze faster, which can cause much bigger frost heaves. And so as this freeze-thaw cycle happens annually every spring, you start to see stones emerging from the landscape. And you need to do something with those stones because there's so many of them that they're getting in the way of your plow. And as we've already established, timber was a really valuable resource. And so you really, really didn't want to do anything to damage any of your tools. If you ran over one of these stones with your plow, you might break it. If you lived somewhere like this farm, you had a long way to go to try to fix it or fix it yourself. And so that was really not a possibility. So farmers would joke that the only thing that they could grow out of the soil was just rocks. And so it was kind of a family affair. Every year, everyone had to gather together and get all of these rocks out of the way that were just coming up from the ground. And so on these parcels of land, especially in Vermont, you would usually get about 100 to 103 acres per farm. And so when we're walking through the woods and finding these stone walls and thinking we're hitting land boundaries, think about the next 100 acres. And if you found that stone where you're standing, you're not going to want to carry it to the edge of your property. You're going to want to carry it to however far you have available for your farm fields for what you're tilling. So you didn't need to go too far with your stones. As you can see in this image, this stone wall aligns that field quite nicely. And also there's a little bit, looks like a wooden fence maybe along the other half of that path. And so you would start to clear these stones, and you wouldn't, the bigger ones you couldn't lift more than thigh height. And so you really didn't want to work too hard to get these out of the way. And so they would often only encompass your farm fields. And so you would use your oxen and get like a stone boat, which was just a flat piece of lumber or something you would build to pile the stones all on that could ferry them to the edge of your field. And then once you got there, you were probably just tossing your stones into a line, essentially not necessarily stacking them orderly, but trying to get them out of your way. Especially early on, there were just so many stones coming out of the ground. And so early stone walls were really kind of linear refuse piles. There weren't a lot of time or care taken into them. And sometimes if you had really large boulders in the middle of your field, you would take the stones to that boulder and sort of pile them on top. There were other ways to move those giant boulders. You could dig a large pit next to it and try to topple the boulder into it and then cover it up with dirt and more stones. Or you could try, if you were skilled enough, to break it down into smaller stones and then remove those to the edges. Later on, as land became a very precious commodity and on its own, you would probably go back and remove those piles if you wanted to. Everyone had a different idea of stone wall building and piles versus no piles, or going back and removing the piles. So it kind of depends on the individual farmer, his skills, his preferences, and how long he was utilizing his land. And so this is a fairly early clearing image. We can see the hills behind this farm are still pretty forested. Got a little log cabin sitting there with a very small little field barn behind it. Maybe some apple trees up in front of the house. And so far, just a fairly small, flat little field. We start to look at some real life examples of these stone walls. We can see one of those large boulders over to the left sort of anchoring this wall. The decision was made to stack the stones around it instead of trying to move it. And that may have determined how big this field was. This is an example of the stone piles, very, very large boulder. You're not gonna try to dig a hole and tip that into it or anything. And then sometimes we see stone walls with really small stones. This one is pretty impressive for how little these stones are and how tall and straight this wall still is. And so what you can try to infer from some of these wall examples is stone walls that have much larger stones were probably pasture lands. You didn't need to work too hard to remove the really small stones from your pastures, but you wanted enough room for your animals to be able to graze. And so you're not gonna see these really, really small stones until you know the wall is abutting some kind of cropland, tilling land, where you're really working the plow. And even running into one of these much smaller stones would mean weeks of work to get back on track. And then there's two different types of stone wall building. Usually we can see this one on the left with these really, really large stones. Is a single wall. They're all sort of stacked on top of each other. And then what we can see on the right is a very small example, but it still counts, is a double layer wall or a double wall. So you can see larger stones were placed on either side and then much smaller ones were sort of infilled into the middle. And the thought process behind that was if you put the smaller stones in the middle, it would create less space for frost eaves to form in the wall itself. So you wouldn't have to work quite as hard the next year to restack your wall to then put more stones on top of it. And so a very happy accident happened in order to sort of make higher use, I guess you could say, out of these stone walls. So if we follow our timeline, we're abutting right up to about 1810. This is right around after all that clearing is happening. The first initial walls were being built. They're sort of piles around the farm fields. And about this time, Napoleon is conquering and invading Spain and Portugal. And the consul to Portugal, William Jarvis, takes advantage of this high level of confusion and takes 4,000 of these Merino sheep, which were unique to Spain. They had a trading embargo on them. They weren't allowed to be leave the country. And so he essentially smuggled 4,000 of these sheep back to the United States, decided to retire before anyone figured out what was happening, and purchased a farm in Wethersfield, Vermont. And it was his understanding that the very rocky, very hilly, and mostly cleared farms and hills of Vermont would make a great pasture land for this particular breed. They're really hardy. They have incredibly thick fleeces. They have a large volume of sheep to fleece ratio. And it was really, really high quality wool that they could produce. So it was a really incredibly valuable sheep and a pretty good secret kept by the Spanish for a long time. And so we see their arrival in Vermont in 1811. And at this point, they were selling for like 3,000 a head because they're so valuable. And they sort of bring in this era of specialized farming in Vermont. It's really the first wave of specialized farming, because up until this point, Vermont farms were subsistence farms. They were very diversified. Basically, they had to produce everything that they needed themselves. If you needed anything else, you could barter with your neighbors. There weren't necessarily established markets or any routes or transportation corridors to get to markets. So you didn't necessarily need cash because you couldn't really spend it anywhere. And so your value was in the things you could produce. And if you run out of hay, then you could ask for extra hay from your neighbor and let him use your oxen in the spring. So there are a lot of different ways that we were sort of surviving winter, essentially, with subsistence farming. And so the sheep bring in this first idea of market agriculture. And we start to see these stone walls as having a real use now, an actual value with the landscape itself. So suddenly we needed to sort of shore up our stone walls, make sure that the sheep couldn't make it over them and get out, because the sheep themselves were so valuable. And so you start to see flocks like this cropping up all over the landscape. And within a couple of years, those 4,000 sheep become thousands. It's pretty incredible how quickly these sheep take over the landscape. And then as soon as we move forward into the 1820s a little bit more, we see in 1823 and 1825, the Champlain and Erie canals officially open. And suddenly this very small Vermont market has access to much wider markets. These canal systems are some of the first real market corridors. And we now have an avenue to move much larger volumes of wool on a national scale and also international scale. In 1812, we see the War of 1812, and there's a blockade on trade with Britain. And so suddenly we don't have access to imported wool anymore. And so this is all kind of happening all at the same time, a very happy accident between the sheep arriving. Suddenly we need local wool made in the United States. And then we have these avenues opening up so that we can really move this wool around. And so the sheep farming really lasts until the 1840s. And it's interesting, you see in the 1820s, there's different tariffs that are after the War of 1812 was over. We see these tariffs that are landing on these trade markets, and they're created by people who live in Vermont. people in Pulteney and Shoreham are sort of responsible for these original tariffs on imported wool. And so these are some of the higher concentrated areas in the state that had the sheep farming. So it's kind of funny to see them making sure that their investment was safe, essentially. Unfortunately for them, as we move into the 1830s and the 1840s, we start to see these tariffs get removed. And suddenly, as land values in Vermont especially, but also wider New England area, they after so many decades of intense farming, and now we have little sheep hooves all over the landscape, causing even worse erosion than just the initial land clearing. We started to see an exodus out west, and this is just to the Ohio River Valley. That's really the frontier at this point. But these canals that first opened up the sheep market are also now starting to ferry people out west to more wider available lands that are easier to farm and slightly cheaper to raise these sheep on. And so this is a view of Berlin Pond in Vermont, and you can kind of get an idea of how much this landscape was cleared. You can see the hills in the background have almost no trees on them. And so this was a real, real problem because this soil was getting so degraded. Anytime we had any sort of high water event, a rain event, the soil would just wash away. So you would have really, really severe flooding because you no longer have these trees on the hillsides to sort of soak up the rain. And so anytime any small amount of blight happened or high water event happened, you would be in a real tough spot if your farm was in the way. And so we start to see, this is that same farmstead from earlier on, and now it's a little bit bigger. Obviously the land is cleared. The house has no longer a log cabin. It's much bigger now. There's now an established barn. There's a road that goes through here. You can see an apple orchard is definitely established next to the house. There's much more stone walls around these fields. There's also a stone wall that goes along the road, because despite the continual packing down of roads, they still had stones that came out in the spring, and sometimes those had to be moved to the sides too, which is pretty incredible. So if we revisit our stone wall back at the Ricker farm, we can sort of start to think about all of these clues that are going on and really start to look at the size of the stones, the orientation of the wall and the landscape. So far, this is the first real evidence we found of the farm so far. And so if we start to look at the forest around the stone wall, you can start to piece together where we are on the farm. So if you think about the farmhouse and the farmyard and the barn and the barnyard as being sort of the center hub of activity on farms, everything else sort of radiates out by energy use. And so you would expect next to this hub and the kitchen garden and the barnyard and all that, you would want to have ideally your croplands, your tilling lands, lands you're going to be spending a lot of time in on a daily basis. And the next one out from there, you would probably put your pasture where you want to run your animals and your livestock. Even further out from that, maybe your woodlot or your orchard. Sometimes orchards were closer to the house. Sometimes they were out towards the back. So if we think about that, we haven't seen a house, we haven't seen a barn yet, and we're moving uphill, we can start to look for clues in the trees for perhaps which side of the stone wall the animals and the pasture land was on and which side the crops were on. As you can see in these two photos facing this direction and then in the opposite direction, we've got some big trees on the uphill side, pretty significantly bigger than anything else in either of these photos. And the first thing that's gonna happen to these little trees is they sprout. If they're anywhere near sheep, they're gonna get browsed. So it's safe to assume that this uphill side did not have any sort of dedicated pasture land on it. These big trees also would have been right along these stone walls, would have been a great source of shade for these animals. And so that's why if you're working off of your crop or your tilling land, the farmer probably would have left those alone to sort of create that nice shade opportunity. And so if we're thinking about moving up on this landscape as we're crossing from the downhill pasture land up to this uphill crop tilling land, the next thing we might expect to find would be either the house or the barn. And so this is the first cellar hole that appears on this particular farm. And then we can start to walk around this and start to explore and think about, is this the farmhouse? Is this the barn? And what is visible in this structure that tells us exactly what its use was? You can kind of see in the background, there's a granite stone slab over here. they sort of line the outside of this whole foundation. You can see this one is pretty high quality. It's got these quarry marks in it, these long sort of shafts from the drilling marks coming in. And these would have most likely been the lintel stones that the house would have sat on. So this would have prevented them from sitting directly on the land and absorbing any moisture from the dirt. And another clue that we can hope to find in house foundations, especially like this one, is mortar. So this is pretty solid evidence of a lime-based mortar. It's hard to tell in photos, but if you're there on the ground, you can try to break it up in your fingers. Lime-based mortar is very easy to break apart with just finger strength. Even these small little bits would be a lot harder to break apart if there were concrete mixed in. And so you can kind of start to date this house. So this lime mortar would have been used until about the 1860s. So we can kind of start to piece that together with our timeline that this house was, or at least this portion of the house was built before the 1860s. And what we would expect to find on these smaller farmhouses, this is a foundation that's out in Williston. This is probably one of the coolest foundations I've ever encountered. Whoever built this was incredibly skilled. it's a very thick foundation and it's a really tight foundation. With the exception of that left side, it's incredibly well maintained despite being totally exposed to the elements.
That is really cool, Sam. With the trees growing up in there as well?
Yeah.
I'm going to share the poll results so people can see what their thoughts are. But you can keep on cruising along. Thanks for sharing that picture. That's very neat.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah, so what we see is, Lauren was pointing out, we've got some trees in this foundation. There's that central tree that's sort of growing up out of this mound in the middle. You can kind of see sort of a little brick hanging out in here. So this brick is evidence of what would have been a central chimney house or a cape house. So this would have been the original brick arch that would have supported the rest of the chimney. And then we can see here what that would have looked like. We've got these two graphics here showing how to build your brick arch around the foundation. It almost looks like this could have been this exact house. I mean, there's even a little staircase right to the left side, just like that. And as you build up your first floor and then your second floor, if you have a second floor, you can kind of see how this chimney sort of anchors the house structurally, but it also allows different openings for fireplaces along the flue. That would have also helped to really warm a house like this in the winter. A lot of that brick would have radiated heat out and that would have been fairly comfortable. Houses like this usually went through 30 to 40 cords of wood a winter, which is pretty incredible. It's not hard to see how we deforested Vermont so quickly. Some houses even had to use up to 60, which is just hard to fathom. But thankfully we don't rely on wood quite as much today. So these are some examples of cape houses with the central chimneys. The ones on the left have been sort of redone with wood stoves, it looks like, but they pretty much would have looked like that originally. You can kind of see a more vernacular version on this bottom left, slightly more stylized, but still fairly vernacular right above it. Vernacular just means I don't want to use the word plain because I still think these are really beautiful houses, but a little bit more plain, less stylized, less decoration. And sometimes you could find cape houses made out of brick. What's interesting to point out about the difference in these houses is there were two variations. There was a central chimney and then you also have these end chimneys. And then this bottom right photo is the actual Ricker farmhouse. This is what would have been standing on top of that foundation. So you can see the much older cape house with this L that was added on most likely at sometime after the 1860s. You can see the windows on this porch. Those panes are much larger than the rest of the windows. And that's a much later glass technology to make panes that large. So as we move through this property by process of elimination, at this point, we would hope to find the barn or a barn structure, the barnyard. But what's important to point out is this history hike, especially at Little River, is on a loop. So it's possible you could encounter this structure first on your way down. And so there's several ways that stand out that you can determine this is the barn before you've ever encountered the house or the stone wall to know quite where you are on the property. So this is a much larger, much more substantial foundation. You can see this very, very large birch tree sitting over here. And you can just barely make out this sort of lower stone wall right here beneath my feet. And then what's especially evident is that there is sort of a missing fourth wall out here. There isn't necessarily a corner in another large continuation of the foundation like you see over at the house. You can see the stones in the wall are much larger. It's a little bit hard to tell from this angle, but they're basically boulder size. They're very, very large. So you would need large stones to hold up a much larger, much heavier structure with a lot more weight in it. You can kind of see where this corner and that huge birch tree is sitting right on the edge of this foundation. And you can see the very clear absence of the fourth wall over here. And so this was a very classic bank barn foundation. So these barns were built into the bank with an intentional opening on the bottom floor. This is the actual barn that sat on that foundation. What isn't visible in the photos is this very small, low stone wall down here. This is the downhill side of the barn. And so these bank barns were built in, they're also sometimes called gravity barns by the way that the energy was used. So you would take your hay or your raw materials and you would load them up into the hayloft, which would be the topmost floor of this barn. And you would shovel that down to the middle floor, which would have been accessed from where this birch tree is growing as sort of the main floor of the barn. So this is where you would have kept your livestock. You can kind of see these little windows for ventilation and also for light on this main floor where the livestock lives. So the livestock would consume the hay, the raw materials, and then process it and expel it as manure. And so you would take the manure from this main level and shovel it down into the basement or the manure basement. And then you would keep this opening so that you could enter the barn and sort of muck out the hay towards your crops from there. And these lower portions of these bank barns provided a lot of great storage. They were also used as some of the earlier silos, which were horizontal rather than vertical. They were used as root cellars. You could sometimes put your pigs in there in the winter. It was a pretty warm place to be. And these were pretty versatile structures that were fairly easy to add onto. You can just barely see towards the left edge of this photo, some sort of a high-rise ramp with the entrance. And so it was really easy to keep adding onto either end here, and you could keep extending out your barn as space was required for either storage or your increasing your livestock herds. In this case, this barn was used for dairy cattle farming. This was after the sheep bust happened, after the large boom in the 1820s and the 30s. In the 1840s, we started to transfer back into dairy farming. Essentially, the tariffs on the wool were taken away, and wool was flooding the market from the west, and suddenly these very hilly Vermont farms that were really sort of struggling from erosion and a lot of other problems. And they were getting a lot smaller as families were growing, there was just less space. So suddenly it was a lot harder as we're transitioning into market farming to create this surplus and to have extra left over to sell to the markets that were now opening up. In the 1840s, we see the arrival of the first railroads, which was really sort of the last nail in the sheep industry in Vermont. Because as soon as the railroads opened up, I mean, the canals were fantastic and revolutionized market trading, but railroads were much faster, much cheaper. They operated on schedules. And in 1849, we see the railroad comes into Waterbury. And so at that time, farms like these would have, smaller farms like this one, would have transitioned to sort of a more diversified set of crops and goods. And especially as we see the railroad come in, those are sort of concentrated in urban centers. And as we're seeing, especially in mill towns, created by the incredible need to process all of the wool over the last several decades. These are urban populations that are much higher concentrations of people. They don't have as much land as they did on their rural farms. And so there's a real need for perishable goods to be provided to these urban centers. And so these farms, as they start to diversify back into dairy, they're creating really valuable cheese and butter and starting to grow sort of vegetables and starting to grow slightly more crops than they were before, as the sheep become a lot less lucrative. So those first original sheep that I said sold for about 3,000 a head are now selling for about 75 cents, which is basically you were just trying to get rid of your sheep. If you were wealthy enough, you were buying out your neighbors and the smaller farms around you and concentrating more on sheep breeding. During this era in the 1840s and 50s, we start to see some really high quality Vermont sheep breeds emerging on the market. And now that we have railroads, they can get out west much faster, where it's much cheaper and easier to raise sheep. So for the people that had the resources, they were able to sort of ride out the sheep bus because they weren't really producing wool, but they're producing really high quality sheep with much bigger fleeces and much more high quality wool than even the original merinos. A few people went too far in the breeding process and ended up with some real duds, but there are a couple prominent Vermonters that were really revolutionized the breed and sort of made it out. And so these people on these smaller farms that were selling out their lands to be used as sheep pastures, we start to see some of the very first return of the forests in Vermont. And you start to see some of those old stone walls that were once sort of valued higher than they used to be start to fall down a little bit. And suddenly, another event that's happening in the 1840s is the Irish potato famine. And so you start to see this high influx of Irish immigrants coming into the United States, and they're finding work building our railroads. And in places like Waterbury, we start to see them buying out these hill farms as the railroad is taking out the farmers that are now abandoning their lands. The Irish are sort of taking them over. And there's another sort of phenomena that happens during this time in Vermont. We've got these old farms, we've got these much smaller farms, they've all got stone walls. And we have an abundance of labor because these giant sheep farms no longer need all their farm laborers, but what they do need is someone to fix up these stone walls. And so what we see is some of these, there's some really great quotes about stone wall building. So if we think back to the wood fences being perishable work, we start to see, and even as early as the 1820s, poor fences are evidence of idleness or poverty or both. And then we fast forward into the 1880s as agriculture has shifted into market farming, which was, you see a need to protect your livelihood, protect your investment. And then you start to see quotes like, "A farm well surrounded and divided by good stone walls presents the image of tidy, skillful, profitable agriculture." And so this is an era where these really highly prized sheep suddenly need to be kept in. Other farms are diversifying into cattle, which are a lot better at escaping stone walls than sheep are. They need to be a lot taller. We start to see the emergence of fence viewers in town municipal governments. Fence viewers had to walk fences, and essentially you would get fined if you were, your fences, your stone walls were found to be falling down. Especially in the 1880s, that's after the emergence of barbed wire, you can suddenly make your stone walls much taller, much faster by running barbed wire and fences along the top of them. And then that sort of lasts a little bit into the early 1900s. This is a nice example of another bank barn. You can kind of see the basement on this has been more enclosed over time, but this is a really nice example of an early English barn that was moved onto a basement foundation and sort of built up to be a bank barn. There's a lot of Innovation on farmsteads in Vermont, reusing old materials. I mean, this was a whole building that they could repurpose, and they decided to do just that. This is two English barns put end to end. As I was saying, these bank barns and then the much earlier English barns were really easy to add onto as more space was needed. You can see these two double leaf door sets delineating the two sides of these barns. So the earlier English barn was about 30 by 40. It was one story. It had these vertical boards on it. They were usually pretty loose. There was a lot of airflow. You needed a lot of airflow for your cattle and for your hay. And this is the interior of that barn. You can see behind this low wall was sort of the hay mow. The central floor was for driving your wagon onto or wagon storage, and I'm standing in the area where they would have kept their cattle. And that was really all you needed for these early subsistence farms. These are very small structures, very simple. And then as time wore on, you would add additions, build bigger barns. Sometimes these old English barns would be left out in the fields where they were constructed. So if you're driving around the state and you see those old barns in the middle of the fields falling down, that's what they originally would have been used for. And then this particular barn shows a unique style to the Northeast, because these earlier English barns were the tradition that we brought over from England. And as you can see in this photo, these doors are right underneath the eaves, and we get a lot more snow than England does in the winter. So every morning you had to come out and clear the snow from in front of your doors. And eventually, it took a few decades, unfortunately, but eventually someone figured out, why don't we put the doors on the gable end underneath this peak so that you don't have to spend quite as much time clearing out all that snow. And another feature that's unique to this Ricker barn is this awesome silo foundation.
So Sam, is what makes an English barn having the door on the side there?
Yes, on the underneath the eaves, yep. And then it's later funny. On you see Yankee or New England barns move them to the end.
Okay, great.
Yeah, both styles lend to additions really easily because you just continue to lengthen your barn. But what's really neat and unique about the silo is that one, it's on a hill farm, and two, it's round. So these early silos, as I said previously, were actually horizontal. They were usually sometimes built into the barn foundations themselves. They were longer than they were tall, and you really had to compact your grain down as tight as you could. And you would often put boards on top just so that you could reduce the amount of oxygen that was reaching the grain so it couldn't spoil. Eventually figured out gravity works pretty well for that same process, but the earliest silos were square, which meant that grain could build up in the corners and would spoil. And so these circular ones figured out, if you get rid of the corners and you build it up early on with wood, you could kind of have the iron braces, sort of like a giant barrel holding it all together. And this one is a really neat example of one that has a really substantial foundation attached to it. You can kind of see this is right up next to this, to the barn. It's close by. And so it's this idea of additional storage. So this farm was pretty successful. It had a huge barn attached to it, and it even needed more space. And so this is really indicative of that market farming surplus mentality. As they became more successful, they needed a little bit more storage space. And as the railroad came into Waterbury, it was pretty neat to see that additional access to market routes that they could build something like this. This is concrete that is lining the fieldstone foundation. Concrete is after 1860s. And so this barn and farm continued to sort of evolve and revolutionize along with changing farming technology, which is pretty incredible considering how far up a mountain it is. But the Rickers were fairly successful. They had some wealth when they arrived, so they weren't necessarily hurting, I guess, for resources, but they still figured out a way to create a livelihood for themselves, especially being so close to Waterbury. This was a dairy farm, so you can imagine a lot of the dairy products that they're sending down to the mills that were in Waterbury. As barn needs evolved over time. Those old English and bank barns were pretty dirty. As we could see, they had some ventilation with those tiny little windows, but not a lot. And eventually a lot of basements were added on. This is an example of a ground level stable barn. You can see the floor is all concrete. It's much more organized. Each cow had its own feeding bowl, place to stand. Everything's whitewashed. This is a really bright, really airy space. I mean, it's got a very shallow ceiling, but much, much cleaner as sort of sanitation measures and everything evolved over time. We started figuring out that like cows hanging out on wooden floors with manure was not very clean. And so as we start to move forward and dairy becomes the prime agricultural resource for the state, we really need to start to protect it more. We start to figure out that the grain that we're feeding our cattle, how we're storing it in the silos, having it being much more nutritionally dense, it creates better milk, creates better butter, creates better cheese. And so we start to see this focus on agriculture as something that really needs to be protected. And this is around the turn of the century, the 1900s. And we're seeing more as space and storage needs are increasing. We're having issues with those old stone walls that are out on our fields because they're small fields. They were what you could do manpower with a man and oxen in a day. And suddenly we have machines now that can do twice as much, twice as fast. And so suddenly you start to see quotes of these old stone walls imprisoning fields. And it becomes really difficult to sort of eke out a living on this landscape because you're on these hill farms that have just endured an incredible amount of erosion and pressure from farming over time. And we're starting to see as the railroads come in, people are continuing to move out west. As we move into the 1860s, you see the first Homestead Acts, 1862, essentially giving away free land as long as you go out and improve it and clear it and start to grow crops, you basically got your deed. And that was something that was hard to pass up for families like the Rickers that had been living up on that hill for generations. And so this is the Ricker barn seen from the house, essentially, is right behind the person taking this photo. And so this farm continued to be used until the 1920s was when the grandson finally sold it to Green Mountain Power. For those familiar with the Little River State Park, there's the Waterbury Dam at the bottom of the hill. And that was built up as a way to protect the higher populated areas from these incredibly devastating flooding events coming down off these hillsides that are just starting to become reforested. You can kind of see up past the barn, there's some woods up there on that hill. And so Green Mountain Power started buying up the lands above the dam so that they wouldn't be interrupting any farming work. And so things just sort of continued to evolve and we moved down from the hillsides and moved out west and spread out a little bit more. And then we start to revisit these areas and piece them all back together. So that's pretty close to the same view today. And actually it did snow today, so it is also snowy. So that's sort of the end of the story for the Ricker family who was up here for three or four generations before they eventually had to move on. But I don't necessarily think it's a sad story because we still have these great resources left behind that we can rediscover and piece back together and recreate on these old farmlands that are thankfully now being reforested and helping to increase the health of the land in the state again.
Well, that's awesome, Sam. Is that an old bed frame? Is that what that would be?
That is an old bed frame. This house continued to be used as a hunting camp. I guess one extra thing to note is that these buildings didn't deteriorate. They were removed from the landscape. So it takes a lot longer than the 1920s for a house like that to fall in on itself and disappear, I guess.
And that would be related to what you were saying of how people like, you know, wood was valuable, timber was valuable, and so things were reused.
Yeah, even stone walls were reused. You can see a lot of house foundations continued to be built out of them after the farmers moved on.
Cool. Awesome. We had another question as well, that the circular silo, mm-hmm. You know, is that unusual? Is that specific to people that have the ability to build that? It seems like it would probably be a little bit more complex. So how common is that versus the, you know, a rectangle like they had?
It's fairly rare to see for Vermont, any of these old original silos hanging around. Sometimes they're built into the interiors of these barns. There's a few hanging around. I always get really excited whenever I see one and have to like stop traffic and pull over and document it. But yeah, I would say it's pretty surprising for a hill farm like this to need something like that and have the resources to install it. But early wooden ones just deteriorate much faster, and we're often, for farms that continue to be used, replaced with the more modern concrete and what we now think of as silos. So
yeah. And then we have another question of, so a lot of this came from Waterbury and the Little River area, but I think people are probably interested in, and Gene is asking, is there a map of this stuff, or can they go out and look at the Ricker farm?
Yeah, so the Little River State Park has maps on its website. It was easier to tell a complete story about the Ricker family and sort of take you through an intact farmscape, I guess. But these features are everywhere. I had to like really control myself for how many photos I was putting in this, because there's so many more examples of stone walls and houses and stuff all over the state, often on private land. So you just have to really make sure you're paying attention to property boundaries. If you're out exploring in the woods, make sure you have permission. But yeah, there's resources like this all over. You don't have to go very far into the woods to find it. But this particular site is very well mapped out, very well researched. There's a lot if you just Google it.
Yeah, so I think everyone look at the Vermont State Parks. They've got, you know, I think I've seen what you're talking about now, that I think of it. And Little River is such a cool place just for recreation in the first place, but also for mm-hmm. seeing things like this.
Yeah, it's vast. This was a very large town that used to be up here. There's a cemetery just beyond the house. Didn't have time to get to that, but
is there any way, Sam, to tell what the original lot boundaries were? So are there out in the field, are there still markers of where Ricker Farm would have been next to the Dally Farm or something?
Oh, sure. Yeah, if you can find them, if you're lucky enough to find them. Sometimes there were stone piles, sometimes there were trees. Those don't last as long. Sometimes stone piles were later replaced with iron rods. The best way to sort of start to piece together how big the farm was would be to go through the town records. So there would be deeds for this land. There would be maps with the original parcel boundaries for this piece of property. And you can start to, as you read through the deeds, it will very clearly describe in rods and chains, which you can translate that into feet, but this many rods and chains to this particular tree or to this particular boulder or stump. And you can actually use those and go out on the land and like walk the boundaries yourself. And deeds are also super important because they can reference stands of valuable timber. It wasn't just the house buildings that they were changing over. Cedar was particularly important. So oftentimes you'll see references to that, and you can really start to piece together different types of crops were grown. Agricultural censuses are great for that. You can really get a whole snapshot of a family from digging into the record side of things.
Cool. Yeah, the deed research must be a little, like, could be hard to stop sometimes, I imagine.
For sure. I have to remind myself to stop and like have a snack. Sometimes it can be a long slog, but it's really cool because they're all handwritten. So it's a really great way to get to know someone personally, to read their handwriting. So
that's cool. And we have two other questions, one from Sally and one from Jennifer. Sally is asking if you know anything about Honey Hollow near Jonesville. Sally says that she's seen lots of walls and cellar holes around there.
That is not one that I have explored yet, but there's so much all over the state, so.
Yeah. And then Jennifer was asking if a stone wall deep in the woods just stops, what happened? Was it removed or repurposed or changed or something?
Yeah, sometimes that can be hard to put together. You'd have to have a lot of time on your hands to survey, figure out, like, you could look at the stones in the wall, figure out, are they big, are they little? Are you on pasture land or cropland? And then when they stop, either the fourth piece or like the fourth wall for a stone wall sometimes were made out of wood. Sometimes a barbed wire fence took over from there, depending on when it was all built. It's possible it was repurposed. Sometimes you leave with more questions than answers, which is also kind of the fun part going in here. Especially if you go out to the same site over and over and over and over again, you will always find something new that you missed. So
it seems like Jennifer, go look more in the woods and see everything.
yeah.
Oh, and I don't know if we got the poll answers. How about I do that? And then we're nearing the beginning of the next hour, so we might conclude after that. So I can share these results again. Really cool to see the mixture of people. And, you know, as Sam said, if there's not a wall that you explore that you know of, then maybe go find one. Go to the Ricker Farm, take a look, and just see what it's like to be in these big behemoth things. Sam, I think the correct answer for number two is 250,000. Is that correct?
Yes, over 250,000.
I want to ask how that was calculated, but that seems like it would be a hard thing to do too accurately. They use LIDAR?
I'm not sure how they calculated that, but I'm sure LIDAR was probably used part of it. I know you could do, if you had two men, you could build 10 feet a day. And the average farm had about 5 miles, just by how big we know, or like how much you could, with the early plows, how big those farm fields were. And so I think it's a rough estimate given population density and all that. So
cool.
More math than I'm capable of figuring out.
Yeah, that's interesting. And then most of you got this. This is a thing that I learned last week from Sam. There are more stones in the stone walls of New England than in the pyramids of Giza, which is pretty wild. The other one that we discussed was there are enough stone walls in New England to stretch to the moon.
And back again, and like back again, I think. But I'm also, somewhere in my brain is telling me the US coastline is like 95,000 miles. So if you think about that in terms of how many stone walls there were, how many times you could line the country.
Wow.
The coast.
That one's cool too.
That one I'd have to Google, figure out exactly. But
and then Sam, one last question, I guess, for you. Is there a website where we can learn more about your work?
Yes, turnstoneresearch.com is my website. I've got more of the things that I offer on there in terms of the different research that I do. I would be remiss not to mention the Vermont Master Naturalist Program, which Lauren had mentioned in the beginning. That's how we met. VermontMasterNaturalist.org. There's a lot of chapters all around the state. And it's a really, really fun, cool program to sort of take what I did today with these stone walls and split up all of the layers of the landscape and figure out how all of these things interrelate with the trees and the geology and the wildlife. And there's a much richer story than even what I covered here today. So.
Cool. Well, thank you so much, Sam. And thank you everyone for joining out there. Go out and check it out. If you're on the long trail, if you're on a hike anywhere, you're driving down I-89 in some places and you look in the median, you can see stone walls. So just keep your eyes a little bit more open and ask more questions, I think would be the moral of the story. And thank you, Sam, for your time. And we'll chat a little bit later, but this was wonderful.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
And everyone, check out the next year, 2021, and watch for future presentations. So thanks for coming. Have a good night.